All right, everybody, welcome to the TNA Impact Wrestling Review for August the 29th, 2013. This week's episode kicked off with Bully Ray and the Aces and Eights in the ring, as well as the amazing, magnificent Brooke Tessmacher slash Brooke Adams, whatever the hell you want to call her, I don't care. So basically, we get Bully Ray being a tyrannical kind of leader here, coming off saying it doesn't matter what the rest of the group thinks anymore. He's giving Tito Ortiz his own cut, and this group is, you know, his group, and that he is the world champion. He's the one that makes the decisions. So the rest of the Aces and Eights are starting to have a problem with that, primarily the vice president, Ken Anderson. So we see a little more of their reaction a few minutes after, where they have some kind of idea in their head that Bully Ray will not like. They're basically pissed off because they're not getting a fair say. This is supposed to be a club, a group of men, not just one leader, and he makes all the decisions and everybody else has to just go along with it. Good news for all of us that are not a huge fan of the Aces and Eights angle, because guess what? I really don't like this angle anyway, and this could be the beginning of the end of this stable. Please, dear Lord. Things are looking up. But anyway, I thought this was actually a fairly good opening segment, and if you are going in the direction of Bound for Glory, let's see, that's not even 2 months away now. Hard to imagine, but that's not even 2 months away now. So if you go into it thinking, with BFG less than 2 months away, the breakup of Ace and Nate's culminating at that pay-per-view makes sense if you're really getting it, planting the seed of thought here and now. Maybe it'll be over before then. I don't give a shit. It could end tomorrow for all I care. It doesn't even have to end. It can just be over and it never happened, and I wouldn't be that upset. I usually like continuity when it comes to storylines. But anyway, we had several BFG series matches tonight, first of which was Kazarian and Jeff Hardy. Kazarian and Jeff Hardy did pretty good. I mean, it was really just a standard television match, nothing really crazy. Wasn't a great match, but it wasn't too bad. I would say solid. Didn't get a crap load of time, but didn't need a crap load of time. Jeff Hardy goes over via the Swanton Bomb. Now, my initial question was why Ego, the other two members, Bobby Roode and Daniels, didn't come out, because all three of these guys had a match tonight in the BFG series. Why neither of the other guys came out? Apparently, later on in the night, when Roode and Daniels are backstage talking before their matches, saying, we're worried, you know, we want to make sure that we get some points in this BFG series. We need the points. We need to be in the top four to move on to No Surrender. And now that Kazarian lost, you know, they're kind of getting, like, paranoid, worried about it, that Hulk Hogan has prevented them from being able to interfere in matches or whatever. I guess that's why. I would have imagined there would have been a little bit of interference in one of these matches, but I didn't really care, to be honest with you, because all three of the BFG series matches turned out pretty well, including this opener. Jeff Hardy finally gets some TV time. He needs it, and him winning, no problems here. So we get a 2 out of 3 falls number one contenders match for the Knockouts belt. Gail Kim, ODB. I enjoyed this match, actually. I think these two women did better than they had done previously in a couple of their other matches. And honestly, I kind of like the story of ODB having the weak leg, making the comeback after Gail Kim got the initial victory via submission, and then picking up the quick pin, and then eventually the submission victory to go over. ODB going over makes more sense because she's a babyface and Mickey James, the champion, is a heel. I think ODB versus Mickey James would be a pretty solid match. The Knockouts division, it may not be seeing its best day right now. I wonder where the hell Terrence Arell has been lately. I mean, you know, where is she? I mean, they were kind of pushing her as one of the maybe future babyface Knockout champions. I mean, basically the Knockouts belt is like the Divas belt, and just about every person on the roster will get it at some point. Either way, ODB versus Mickey James sounds like a pretty good match. This match here between Gail and her was solid. One big complaint, though, that I have, and it's just a nitpicky complaint, was Mike Tenay's, and I know Mike Tenay had to do this, it's not Mike Tenay's fault. One thing I just don't like is that they were talking and promoting the show that's coming on after Impact while matches were going on, while this match went on, while one of the other BFG series matches was going on. And it just baffled me why they would decide to do it then when they could just do it during the intros when the people are coming to the ring. Why not briefly mention the fact that there's a show coming on next? Instead of promoting the show for a good minute of the match, while the match was actually hitting a very important point, especially during this one, the match was hitting an important point. I mean, Gail Kim had the figure four locked in on the ring post on ODB, and you're not calling that. You're talking about the fact that there's a show coming on after Impact. Why don't you talk about it at more of an opportune time? That is something to me that just is absolutely annoying. And just like, it sounds like, oh, well, so am I supposed to pay attention to the match, or am I supposed to pay attention to this? It's a nitpicky thing, but it is something that, to me, is important when it comes to the presentation of a show. That's just how I see it. anyway, moving on. Decent knockouts match, good number one contender. I liked it. Told a solid story. Wasn't amazing, but it was fine. So Velvet Sky is seen backstage, talk about some kind of personal issues for why she wasn't there at Hardcore Justice. I guess we'll figure more of that out, or we won't see her on TV in about 2 months, because, you know, storylines get dropped all the fucking time. So we get an Austin Aries interview, where he kind of praises AJ Styles for joining MEM, but at the same time says that he doesn't need to be associated with anybody else. Daniels comes in, they have a little confrontation, which was pretty enjoyable, and they're gonna have their match later on tonight. And you know, obviously I was looking forward to that, as well as Styles and Rude. Even though I've seen Styles and Rude a lot, I still think that those two guys tend to put on a pretty good match for the most part. But anyway, we move on to the Main Event Mafia coming out. Very limited Main Event Mafia because of the fact that Magnus apparently had to renew his visa or something, so that's why he wasn't there. Angle's out there getting rehab. So it was basically just Rampage, Sting, and Joe. Rampage just said that he's not waiting till November 2nd to get his revenge on Tito for the attack from 2 weeks ago. Joe kind of pumps the crowd up and says that they run the town, and both him and Sting give AJ Styles a lot of props, and they basically are opening up a spot for AJ in the Main Event Mafia if he wants to join. So AJ comes out with his mixed themes, which I thought was cool. I thought it was cool last week, and I think it's cool now still, too. I'm personally a big fan of that. But he comes out and says he needs to do this promo alone. And this promo turned out to be really good. I honestly thought this was awesome mic work from AJ Styles. I mean, I've never considered him a mic master in it by any means. He isn't the best on the mic, but he sure as hell ain't the worst. He's like decent. He kind of just falls somewhere in the middle of the pack. It's always been his in-ring ability that has gotten him over so well as a big time name. Necessarily, I mean, I'm not saying his mic skills aren't good. He has good mic skills, but he's like a, you know, good, not great. He's not one of the top guys on the mic. But I will say this promo here was quite good. Some of it felt like a shoot, where he says, you know, he deserves better. He stopped trusting anybody because of the actions of his former best friends, people turning their backs on him. He's just not meant to be in a suit and tie. This is not his forte. He is all about him. The only person he can trust is himself. His whole perception of the business has changed. He deserves better. He's always been their go-to guy for what? To just almost sit in the back seat, not really be the number one man in the company. He's only been the go-to guy. He feels almost as if he's been used. I thought this was an awesome promo, but he said, you know what, I like being the go-to guy. I know I can carry this company on my shoulders, and I'm going to, and I'm going to win that Bound for Glory series. And just kind of, this was finally the AJ Styles answering the questions that all of us fans had for a while with this whole gimmick. Where is this? Why is he doing what he's doing? We're getting that explanation now, and it was really well done. He cut a great promo, follows it up right away with this match with Bobby Roode. It was a pretty good match. He ends up going over, as he should, gets the 7 points. He's just out of the top four. He's like the next guy down. My guess is next week he'll end up getting enough points to end up in the top four spots. And from there, he'll end up winning the Bound for Glory series and winning the world title at Bound for Glory. I think he will be the world champion come end of Bound for Glory. I think that is part of their angle, was the big recovery. They're doing a similar thing like WWE would do with John Cena. They're doing a similar angle where they're having him be at his absolute worst and then get all the way back up to the top. He hasn't been world champion since 2010, so let's be honest here. It's not like AJ Styles has been shoved down our throats as the number one guy. It's not like he has been, you know, constantly been the champion without other people having an opportunity with the belt. I mean, for Christ's sake, TNA has put the world title on Bubba Ray Dudley, a guy known for being a tag team wrestler, is your world champion. Chris Sabin has gotten a chance to be world champion. Austin Aries was world champion. I mean, it's not like different people. I mean, he even had Rob Van Dam as champion. I mean, plenty of different people have had the shot at being champion. Bobby Roode has finally emerged as a world champion. James Storm even had a short run with it too. You know, I mean, different guys have gotten a shot at that belt. So AJ Styles has not even, he's only been TNA World Heavyweight Champion one time. I mean, he was NWA champion several times years ago, but he's only been TNA World Champion one time. So him winning the belt at Bound for Glory isn't going to make people complain, myself included. So anyway, seeing AJ Styles get out there, get some really good mic time, and cut a great promo on top of then having a solid TV match to follow, this is great. But anyway, we move on to the main event of the evening, which was Daniels and Aries. Best match of the night, easily. Awesome stuff. Great chemistry between these two guys. Pay-per-view quality feud this could be. Loved it. Aries goes over via brainbuster, as he should. So Ego loses out on the night. I'm guessing this little trio of Ego is going to be a short-lived thing, I would imagine. I don't really know. If they end up being a more long-term thing, I'm not really upset with that. Maybe you could have Bad Influence as the tag champions, and then you could have Bobby Roode going for the world belt again. I don't know. Maybe you could have a six-man feud with the Storm and Gunner feuding with Bad Influence, and then AJ versus Roode as a six-man feud. I don't fucking know. That's just a complete stab in the dark, but why not, right? Why not? I mean, you could make something out of that three-man group, but either way, all three of them end up losing tonight, but all three of these matches were at least solid TV. So, but anyway, Bully Ray ends up talking to Tito Ortiz with the lovely test marker right there. Basically says to Tito Ortiz that he wants him to keep an eye on Ken Anderson. And I'll tell you what I think is going to happen after I talk about the final segment. Of course, I haven't been on TV in a few weeks, brother, but don't you worry. I'm closing the show out, man. That's how the things go around here, Jack. Four-sided ring, Jack. Okay, anyway, I still bother about that 3 years later. But so basically Hogan says it's great to be back. Bully interrupts him, says that a lot has changed since you've been gone. I'm the champion again. But Hogan then, they kind of close out the Brooke Hogan angle by just saying that the divorce is final. It's like, yeah, in other words, she got released. Like, I mean, whatever. But basically, Bully comes out and says, there's nothing you can do about the fact that the Aces and Eights are reigning supreme, and that I am the world champion, and that I'm just going to sit back until Bound for Glory and don't even have to wrestle. But Hogan, of course, comes up with some great matches and says, in 2 weeks, brother, you're going to be defending the belts, hopefully against me. No, I'm just kidding. You're going to be defending your belt against one of your buddies in the Aces and Eights. And then next week, he says this week, because he knows that they're double taping the show. Great job. I just don't even care, man. But this week, you're going to be facing Sting for the belt. And I'm thinking immediately, well, guess what, Hogan? Sting ain't supposed to ever go for the world title again because he lost at Slammiversary. I look on the Twitter for TNA, and they a couple minutes later are already tweeting, by the way, the match between Sting and Bully Ray is not a world title match, just to kind of correct Hogan, which I found funny. But yeah, so in 2 weeks, Bully's going to defend his belt against one of the Aces and Eights member, and it would not take a big stretch of the imagination for you to assume that guy is going to end up being Ken Anderson. And you know, the rest of the Aces and Eights group may not actually help Bully Ray out. You may really start seeing the group come to, you know, being at odds, and then finally at Bound for Glory, it all culminates maybe with them all turning on Bully and costing, end up helping to cost him the world title. I don't know if that's going to be the ultimate case here or not. I guess we'll see where it goes. But either way, the fact that the Aces and Eights angle looks like it's starting to really wrap up and be over within the next couple of months is a blessing. Some solid television matches tonight. We get announcements for bigger matches. Next week, we're going to see Sting and Bully. The week after, we're going to see Bully versus one of his own associates. So we're seeing matches. We know what's coming up. The BFG series is going to have one big blow-off next week where we're going to finally know the top four guys, and then we got No Surrender coming soon. I mean, you know, they at least... I think this is the best Impact I've watched in a while. Last week's was all right. It was better. It was a step up from the other ones. This was a step up from last week, even, I thought, because I thought you had some solid television matches here. You had a consistent theme throughout the night of building up the next couple of shows. You got AJ Styles explanations. You got, you know, announcements for where Bully Ray is going to be. More of the beginning of, hopefully the beginning that the screws are turning for the beginning of the end of the Aces and Eights and what will be the greatest thing that's happened for TNA since June of 2012 when this whole crap began. And that will be the end of the Aces and Eights angle. That's all they need to do. And if it's over next week, the week after, that's fine. If it's over Bound for Glory, that's going to make more sense, but I don't care as long as it's over sooner rather than later. Either way, I thought this was a pretty good Impact. I won't go and say this was the best Impact of all time, don't get me fucking wrong, but I'll give it like a B- because I honestly thought that this was a much better put together Impact that actually went by pretty well. It flowed fine. You know, again, more of a direction. You have a number one contender to the Knockouts title and a solid, some solid wrestling matches. A great promo from AJ Styles. Announcement for where things are going. I felt it just, things just felt refreshed. I mean, it's like you just hit the refresh button on TNA and things seemed a lot better. It doesn't mean that TNA is now wonderful and glorious. That doesn't mean that everything is perfect. But this was easily the best Impact I've watched in a while. Just because it was a well-put-together show. Does that mean that things are always going to be amazing and hunky-dory from here on out? Of course not. But this was a much better put-together show. I was pleased with this. It was a pleasant surprise. I give it a B-. So let me know what you guys thought of this week's Impact in the comment section below. Also, be sure to hit the like button and subscribe for plenty more to come. Follow me on Twitter at the handle EMUltraOfficial, EMULTRAOFFICIAL. The link for that is in the description box. And of course, ask Q&A questions. We have about 10 so far. What can you do the Q&A in about 2 to 3 weeks? But I like between 15 and 20 questions before doing the Q&A. Got about 10 so far. Thank you everybody that has submitted questions. But anybody else who would like to submit questions, I welcome you to do so. Please, at this time, comment section here, personal message, or tweet me your questions, whatever. That's fine. Any of those options works for me. Just make sure you let me know what your questions are for the Q&A. A couple weeks from now, we will upload that. SmackDown review coming tomorrow. That's my plan. Other than that, that's going to do it. So let me know what you guys thought of Impact in the comments. Like I said, like and subscribe if you haven't yet. And thank you for watching. Until next time, peace out.